This is Thursday, August 7th, 2014. We are in Natick, Massachusetts, and this tape is part of the Morse Institute Library's continuing Veterans Oral History Project. My name is Maureen Sullivan. Our cameraman is Dan McDermott of Natick Pegasus. We are privileged to have with us today Dr. Harold Homefield. Welcome, Harold.
Thank you.
May I ask when you were born?
New York, New York.
And when were you born?
March 22nd, 1919.
And what town do you currently live in?
Sudbury, Massachusetts.
Your marital status?
Married.
Do you have children?
Yes.
Now, how many?
Well, I have two daughters and a son.
Okay. Do you have grandchildren?
Yes, I do. Mm-hmm. We have three grandchildren and eight great-grandchildren.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Well, we have to increase the population of the country, you know.
Tell us a little bit about New York City growing up.
Well, we were not very well off. Most people weren't in those days. And I can still remember the Depression very, very precisely. When I was 10 years old, the stock market crashed. And I never forgot picture in the New York Daily News of Wall Street, empty, nobody there except one person, and he's holding up this newspaper and says something to the effect, market crash. That was how they reported the Wall Street crash. And then we heard all kinds of horrible stories about people committing suicide after saving all their lives to take care of their elder years. These folks suddenly became penniless. And it was kind of hard for a youngster my age then to accept that as an excuse, but there was so much of it that it was kind of scary and worrisome.
What part of New York City did you live in?
Well, originally, we lived in Manhattan, and then we moved up to Bronx County.
Mm-hmm. And tell us a bit about your mother and father.
What about them?
What about your mother and father? Like, what did your father do for a living?
Well, my father was very active with the Democratic Party. And somehow they managed to find a simple placement for him. So he didn't make a lot of money, but there was always bread on the table.
Mm-hmm. And were you an only child?
No, I was the oldest of five. My father was the youngest of five, and I was the oldest.
Okay, and you went to New York public schools.
Right.
And what high school did you graduate from?
It's called DeWitt Clinton. There was a governor by that name who had something to do with the development of Lake Erie, the Erie Canal or whatever. But that was before my time.
While you were in high school, were you made aware of events in Europe and Asia?
Not enough. Mm-hmm. But I did have an interest.
And what year did you graduate from high school?
1936.
Okay. And what did you do after graduation?
Well, I wanted to help out my folks a little bit, so I decided to sign up at night college at the Brooklyn College campus of the City University of New York. And I chose that particular school because the little job I found out in New York was much closer to that campus than it was for me to go up north. So that worked out all right.
And what kind of courses did you take?
I took all the required courses, but eventually I drifted into speech pathology. My father once wrote a book when I was about 5 years of age. It was called English for Foreigners. And unfortunately, it wasn't a great success because the people who should have bought that book probably couldn't afford it, or in the first place may not have been able to read the title. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. it was a disaster financially. Mm-hmm. But he never stopped trying to help people.
And how long were you in college?
Well, I started off initially attending at night, mm-hmm. and then decided I had an offer, a strange offer. The place I was working in had some connection to dress manufacturing. They were producing something called bias and binding. And I would deliver these little packages to dress houses. And I got to know the various places there. And then one day, one of my friends told me that one of the gentlemen who owns these dress houses would like me to be a manager of one of his houses. Now, I had never met him, but apparently he was given a lot of interesting information about me. And even though I was so young, he thought I would do the job well. So before accepting, I decided to talk to my father and ask for his advice. I pointed out that if I were to accept that position, it might interfere with my college program, that because there might be night meetings here and there to discuss with the owner what we would be doing in the future and that sort of thing. And so my father thought a while and he said, how would you feel about going full time? And I said, well, that would be very nice, but I'm trying to help out a little bit. And he said, well, I think you really ought to consider it. Well, I did, and I realized that he was right, because otherwise, if I had been able to take a look into the future, I would have realized how important it was. But fortunately, we came to the right decision, mm-hmm. and I went full time. And that's when I started going down to the American Red Cross and developed a good relationship there, and first became an ARC lifeguard, and moved from there to becoming an instructor. Now in those days, there was a new title for it, was called water safety instructor. The old title for that same position until then was examiner. A pretty scary title for an instructor, you see. So I was very pleased to be one of the first of the new title. And after doing that for a while, I realized that that lifeguards should know first aid, at least to some extent. So I started with the first aid program. Mm-hmm. And as I said before, I continued until I became an instructor. That's how the Navy got my name, because they were preparing mm-hmm. for the kind of war we were going to be having with Japan. And I can remember my younger brother writing to me from the Pacific while I was in the Atlantic, and I hadn't heard from him in 2 years, but he followed in my original footsteps and became a corpsman in the hospital corps. So he was involved in 4 invasions of Japanese islands. And he said in the last invasion, they were told to remove their Red Cross armbands, and they were issued sidearms. In other words, they were issued a .45 caliber pistol. And they were told that they should do this because the enemy was using the armbands to help them get a better bead on the target. So that was kind of scary, but he managed to survive. Mm.
And what was your younger brother's name?
Martin.
Martin.
Yeah.
Okay, let's get back to you and the process of being a first aid program instructor for the American Red Cross. The Navy's got your name. It's now about 1940?
Early in 1940.
And
absolutely,
tell us what
around
happened.
February or March or whenever, because I couldn't keep all the records. And incidentally, about a year ago, I decided to write to the Navy and said, I'd like a copy of my record. I was amazed to find that so much was missing. I had no idea that when they had the fire in St. Louis, where they had most, or I don't know what percentage of the records, that mine was one of those that was burned. It never occurred to me. I thought surely it was in St. Louis, but whatever the reason was, they didn't have it fireproofed.
Oh, wow.
That was sad.
Very.
So a lot of people don't have complete records. And since I never felt the need to actually have them correct the records, I hadn't done anything about it, except that lately I was thinking, what if some great-grandchild of mine or whatever decides to look up his family's record? Might be nice if I had more in the record. So I'm thinking seriously if I can find the time to prepare the information that's missing and see if they would then enter it. Mm-hmm. But being caretaker for my sick wife these past couple of years, I really haven't found the time to do that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. But maybe I will if I can stay around long enough.
Okay. Let's get you back to the spring of 1940. You mentioned before the interview you got a letter from the Navy. Take it from there.
Well, I mentioned it before, mm-hmm. where they said that something to the effect that because of my special qualities or information, I don't remember the exact words they use, but they were therefore able to offer me a petty officer rating in the hospital corps, which meant they would be doing, I would be doing what my kid brother was actually doing. Well, anyhow, as I told you, while I was still at the Navy Hospital at the Brooklyn Navy Yard, I was told about the opportunity to go to midshipman school if you had your college degree. Well, am I going too fast?
Go ahead.
Okay. So I applied and was accepted. And that's how I got my commission as an ensign, USNR. Mm-hmm. And was no longer an enlisted person. So it was an entirely different setup.
And just to clarify, you had already received your degree or were you close to getting it?
I was attending at night. They gave, I missed something for you. When I went down to headquarters, mm-hmm. they assured me of all these nice things, but they also assured me that I would not be called unless we went to war. And 3 months later, I was called up and to be the medical officer, no less. By then I was a first aid instructor, Red Cross, but I wasn't a medical officer. So I went down to headquarters and I said, 3 months ago, you gentlemen, told me that I would not be called unless we're going to war. And here I get these orders. I wonder if you can do something about it. Well, at first the officer on duty said, well, there's nothing we could do about it. But apparently it went up to a higher level, and I got a call, and they said, a phone call. And they said, if I come down to headquarters, they have a proposition for me. Would I come down at such and such a date? So I did. And the offer was, if we stationed you at the Brooklyn Navy Yard Hospital and allowed you to attend at night to get your credits, would you be willing to accept that? And of course, I jumped at it. That was exactly what I would have asked for. So that's how I earned my degree while in uniform. And the college was very good, too. They told me I don't have to take final exams, which wouldn't have bothered me, but it was very nice of the college to realize that I was pretty busy all day. So that's how it all started. And when I graduated from midshipman school in May of 1942, I was then no longer required to be single, so that's the day we picked to get married.
Tell us a little bit more about midshipman school.
Well, that was a very fascinating kind of setup. This was a school that was set up as one of the temporary war measures because they wanted to have a lot of different people and would not be able to service us, say, at Annapolis. So they used, in this case, a very old battleship, and I can't remember the name of it now, but she fought in the Spanish-American War.
Whoa.
So it was an old battleship, but in very good condition. Mm-hmm. And the drill deck in the center of the vessel was gigantic. You almost felt as if you were on a football field. At least it seemed that way. It was very spacious, and we were able to do drills like that.
How many people were in, say, your class?
You know, I never stopped to think about it, frankly, but there must have been at least 500. I'm only guessing now.
Tell us a little more about what you learned. Were there any physical drills, things like that?
There wasn't much in the way of physical stuff, but we did learn how to march, those of us who didn't know anyhow. And we took the various subjects that were of importance to officers. So we learned all about the rules of that officers had to follow. There was a certain manual that went with it. And we took the various subjects like gunnery, navigation, seamanship, the rules of the road, so to speak, is the name of the procedures. In other words, if you're out in the middle of the ocean somewhere and you hear a sound of a horn, you have to take a look around to see what it means. So you had to know those kinds of things, the rules of the sea. So my interest basically turned out to be in the field of navigation. And piloting was also involved, but I was very interested in learning about how to use celestial navigation to be able to determine where you are and be able to make appropriate changes if you had to. I found that quite fascinating. So that became a very important point to me. And especially when I became a commanding officer of a vessel, I found that very useful.
Mm-hmm. Were you ever able to use your training in first aid or lifeguard during this period?
Not while in the Navy.
Interesting.
Well, actually, the Red Cross always said, the last thing you do if there's someone in trouble is to personally go in. Otherwise, whenever possible, use a boat or whatever you could to avoid having to go in. It actually happened. I'm jumping ahead of myself now, but if you don't mind, I'll jump
ahead a little bit.
On the ship to which I was assigned, we had, then the ship was assigned to the sonar school at Key West, Florida. And our job was to take out people who were attending classes at the sonar school, learning anti-submarine warfare. And we and about 10 other ships or so working from the same area would take out these groups, enlisted personnel and officer personnel separately. And we'd work with our own submarines. We had about a dozen World War I submarines that were being utilized to do this work. Uh-huh. So one day we had, towards the latter part of the war, incidentally, when the Russians changed sides and came over to our side, we had Russian officers and enlisted personnel come aboard. And we had a translator who was born as an American, but apparently learned Russian from his family. So we were out on one of our drills, and we were at breakfast, and sitting in the wardroom, finishing my breakfast, and one of the officers came in, white-faced, man overboard. So, of course, rushed out there and saw that there was a sailor in the water, and he was sort of struggling. And I knew from my Red Cross training that you get a boat out there, you don't jump in yourself. And having seen the sharks that we, well, not that moment, mm-hmm. but we were operating in shark-infested waters. In fact, well, I'll tell you about a shark later, but these were gigantic sharks. And I wore something that was out of uniform. I carried a hunting knife on my belt. I knew it wouldn't save my life, perhaps, but I figured if I had to be in the water, I wanted to have some means of defense. Well, anyhow, this poor young fellow, the one who was translating for us, suddenly went under and didn't come up again. And so we kept looking way into the night. We were never able to recover the body. So it was obvious to us that some shark had gotten him.
Wow.
And that's just one negative thing that happened. Mm-hmm. But our job was to train these people and to have them actually do what they learned in the classroom out at sea. And in the command center, which was at the bottom lower part of the vessel, they were able to tell what kind of run they made on the submarine. And we, like people like myself or the commanding officer at the time, before I was, we would be up there on the flying bridge and watch what was happening, because the submarine was towing a buoy. And the line was about 100 feet long, and the buoy was somewhat in the shape of a torpedo, but not that big, and painted yellow, because yellow was a good color to have in order to spot where that buoy was. So that's the kind of work we did. And I did that, actually I jumped ahead of myself, but when I was first ordered onto that vessel, it was being completed up in New York at, I can't think of the name of the building, the shipbuilder, but they were just finishing up this particular vessel. Originally, we were told it was built for President Theodore Roosevelt. And this was completely refitted. They put on armor plate all around. We had the same caliber cannon, we call it a 3-inch 50 gun on our vessel, with lots of machine guns around. And when I became commanding officer, it happened, there was some article that we read about where one of our attacking vessels came up close to a submarine, a German submarine that was partially disabled, and he came to the surface. They and their personnel on the destroyer that was adjacent to them started throwing coffee cups at one another. Because they didn't have, when they set up machine guns, they didn't have it so that you could lower the thing right next to your vessel. It was always for distance. So anyhow, that submarine didn't get away, but nobody was killed. However, not that I'm bloodthirsty, but I was there to do a job. So I ordered a Tommy machine gun, to put up on the bridge so that in case we had a situation like that, we would have something to fight with. And I also ordered, hand grenades. Couldn't think of the right word for the moment. And we had some of those up on a board so that we would not throw coffee cups at one another.
Okay, Harold, let's get back to you're an ensign.
My what?
You're an ensign, you've been newly commissioned. Tell us about, was this the first ship you were on, the one where you're throwing coffee cups at each other, or was this before?
Well, not we, okay. But we mm-hmm. This is what we read about. The first ship I was on temporarily for only about a week or so, and an old vessel from World War I, I think, that was put on patrol between Perth Amboy Lightship, Ambrose. I always get that New Jersey area confused, but anyhow, a lightship and Rockaway Point. And our job was to scare the enemy away, because this was a World War I little patrol vessel. And we didn't encounter any enemy, but maybe we did, maybe we chased them away by just being there. That was my first assignment. That was only temporary while I was getting a more permanent one. And that's when I got orders to report on a ship called the USS Phenakite. P-H-E-N-A, and then kite, K-I-T-E. I don't know what it meant exactly. I didn't have a good dictionary aboard ship, so I never really found out. But I think it was some kind of bird, I'm not sure. Anyhow, the first connection with the ship was to come aboard, be there for the shakedown cruise, the degaussing of the ship. Now that's a process by which they make it more difficult for a floating mine to be attracted to a vessel because by degaussing. This was a system that was developed, I think, by a French Navy person, I'm not sure. And all the ships had to go through that to make sure that they would not attract a floating mine. So we did that. We had the shakedown going through various speeds. Basically, those were the facts that were most important.
Just to clarify, was the Phenakite a new ship?
No, it was an old ship that was built for President Theodore Roosevelt.
Okay, that's it. Okay.
A fellow who was president, you know, and the man who was in uniform and charging up San Juan Hill.
So this was the ship that got refitted.
This got rebuilt, and it was a very well-built ship, basically. And we had two Fairbanks Morse engines, which ran very well for the first year. We ran into a little trouble with it once later on. But anyhow, so this was an assignment that we all had. Now, with about a dozen of these vessels taking care of the sonar school people, we maintained that kind of training for 2 years, actually, before anything else occurred. In the meanwhile, I came aboard. The skipper, the captain, was lieutenant junior grade, actually, but he had a lot of experience with yachting. He owned a yacht, and so it was normal for him to get that kind of slot. And there were four officers altogether. I was second in command because I was the executive officer, in other words, because my number was lower than those of the two other officers. And the lower your number or whatever, I don't even remember the details anymore, but the lower your number, the higher sort of rank among the ensigns. And so it gave me good experience. And eventually, I went up the ranks. And this went on for quite a while. But we had periodic assignments after our day's work with these crews. We normally would come back and prepare, stay in overnight, and then take out people in the morning. At one time, When the war was changing, when the Russians came over on our side, I mentioned that before. I'm trying to figure out what it was that. At first, we didn't really trust them. We didn't know, can we really tell them all the secrets, all the things we learned, and would they ever turn against us? That sort of thing went on. So the four striper, the man with four gold stripes running the sonar school, was automatically the commanding officer of these ships. We each had I was the commanding officer. The others were all commanding officers, but he was the sort of admiral. He was a four striper, but that was his title. And there were times when we had some close calls just doing these patrols. For example, one night when I was the commanding officer, I assigned one of my junior officers to the midnight watch because we would have 8 to 12 at night, then 12 to 4, and then 4 to 8 in the morning. So I assigned each officer to a different watch, and I decided to follow up and take the 4 to 8 watch myself and bring the ship in to port. So I came up on deck. Normally you were supposed to report about 20 minutes ahead of time to allow the eyes to get accustomed to the dark in order to get your maximum night vision. And I came up one that time, and instead of 20 minutes, I came up even a little earlier and walked around the ship, and I noticed something in the distance. It was a very dark night, no moon, no stars, and I saw this bulky area move, and I realized there was a ship out there. So I watched for a minute and saw that he was heading at what would have been a collision course with us. So I rushed up to the bridge, asked the officer of the deck if he saw that. No, he hadn't, and he was kind of flustered. So I understood his concern. I said, "I relieve you, sir." And I turned on our running lights, sounded our horn, and made sure we didn't meet. So we could have been smashed to smithereens, because this was a gigantic vessel. And he was on his own, which was very unusual, because no vessel normally ran without some destroyer or something like that accompanying them.
So this other ship, was it another naval vessel?
I couldn't really get to see what was on the side, because it was a very dark night.
Right.
And we lighted up our vessel right away. You don't normally do that in time of war, but this was a matter of life and death. Mm. We would have all been underneath the water. And anyhow, that was an example of some bad things that could happen while you were on patrol.
Now, do you remember at least what year that incident took place?
I would think around 1944, okay. 43 or 44. I didn't keep records of this. There was no opportunity to sit down and fiddle around like that.
So basically during the war, you were stationed around the East Coast?
Yeah, and our job was about once a week or once in 10 days, whatever it was, we'd go out on patrol looking for enemy submarines. Unfortunately, we never found one. Maybe they realized that this was a well-patrolled area, because we covered the area where we worked during the day and around the coast as much as possible within reason. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we went towards Havana, which was 90 miles from us. But if you went, say, 45 miles towards Havana and then started your patrolling, you could see the lights from Havana lighting up the sky above the city. And that bothered me, because I figured they should have had a blackout too if they were neutral and wanted to really get our respect. But I was just a young officer, so I had no control over any of that.
While you were on patrol, aside from dealing with looking for enemy subs, what you remember being out in foul weather?
I was involved in several hurricanes, but the first one was before we entered Key West. We weren't allowed to come in. They said, "Turn around, all the other ships are coming out, and we are going to stay in formation, and you follow my lead." This was the fourth striper, you see. Well, we had a rounded bottom. Didn't seem to have a hull that would keep you from rolling. We took a terrible, terrible beating during that hurricane before we ever entered the actual harbor. And everyone else aboard ship stood our watch, but there was only one very seasoned sailor who didn't become deathly ill. And I mean very ill. There was nothing left internally, it seemed. So somehow we managed to survive. I don't know how. I can remember at one point we were 60 degrees from center and looking down into the water, and I'm saying to myself, dear God, don't send any more water on there. We were just another few drops, I figured, and we'd be over. Mm. But somehow we managed to get back. And then on the way back, we hit 30 degrees. So that wasn't so bad comparatively. But there was only one sailor who I liked, but at the moment I got a little angry, but he saw that I had retched completely and stood my watch. I was on there hanging on, and there were a lot of flying fish washed up onto our ship. Don't forget, we were off this Key West. And this one sailor got a piece of bread and picked up one of these, put him on the bread, and had a very good sense of humor, but I didn't appreciate it at the time. He said, sir, your stomach is empty. You're going to have something to eat. At the moment, I could have walloped him, but I realized it was being very funny. So we had a little bit of humor in the midst of a lot of suffering. But this fellow, I never forgot his name. Lynch was his last name. Nice chap. We were good shipmates. And then after that, we didn't have anything for a while. Mm-hmm. Had no hurricanes. But then, about a year later or so, we had a hurricane somewhere, and I don't remember where anymore. And then I had a third one. And that was it for a while, until after I was back home and had signed up with the Naval Reserve. I just wanted to continue. Mm-hmm. And let's see. Oh, there was one hurricane that we kind of walked into before it started. I was ordered down to Norfolk to go on a certain vessel, a rather large one. And before we were supposed to pull out, we were told there's a hurricane coming. And at first, they thought they ought to stay in the port, but then the ships were told to go out to sea. And we went through another hurricane, but that was post 4 years. So I had actually, I would have to say, there was one more hurricane later on that I went in. So I never enjoyed them, but by the time you hit the second hurricane, you began to get your sea legs pretty well. And the third and fourth were relatively easy, comparatively.
Did you feel that your equipment and training were adequate for what you needed to do?
Yes and no. I wished that the ship had a little higher speed. It had two Fairbanks Morse engines, which were very good on the whole, but after a certain number of years, they gave out one time when we were having a problem. And otherwise, it was pretty good equipment. And I was very fortunate. I had some wonderful personnel from the chief on down in the engine room. So they were able to fix minor problems if they occurred. And only one time did we actually have to have a tow, because something went beyond the ability of our own people to take care of it.
Tell us a bit about that incident.
Hmm?
Tell us a bit about that, the time you needed a tow.
Well, how about, what? I couldn't hear the question.
Tell us a little more about the time your ship needed a tow.
Oh, well, we were approaching some sort of harbor, right? I can't remember. We were heading down south towards New York, because I think that was on our last assignment. And the engine room reported that they were having some problems. And so we had decided to head to the nearest harbor. And as it happened, it was a good thing that we were in close, because when we asked for a tow, they were able to provide it, and we were able to get repaired. So this went on, and I had command of the ship by then, by the way. Mm-hmm. And oh, I know what it was. We were actually ordered down to New York, and I was automatically appointed a senior officer for the Naval Reserve Officer School that I had graduated from. And my main job there was to take out the midshipmen who had been through most of the training and now were ready to get some hands-on instruction at sea. So, for example, I would take a group of midshipmen and show them how to handle the sextant and how to use it, how to read it. That kind of instruction and other pieces of equipment and so on, and to give them the feel of what it's like for a ship to be bouncing around a little bit at sea.
So Harold, what were you doing when you weren't out on patrol?
Well, we took out the people from the sonar school. Mm-hmm. That was our basic, that was what the ship was assigned to do. Mm-hmm. And we were assigned to the ship.
Tell us a little more about the sonar school.
Sonar school was set up to teach enlisted personnel who were trained to do anti-submarine warfare, but were going to get more intense training at this place. Now, I don't know whether they ever had any beginning courses or not. They didn't part with much information, but that didn't bother me at the time. So, that was basically what we did. And I remember when I was a midshipman and went out, I didn't get very much training. I just got the feel of the bouncing and the vessels and that sort of thing. But I wanted the midshipmen, I had developed a pretty good ability to use the stars and sun, moon, whatever. And I wanted them to become aware of the importance of it, just in case the more modernized equipment wasn't working properly or whatever. So it came in very handy for me, and I was very happy to pass that information on to the people who were going to be coming out.
Now, you mentioned earlier in the interview Key West, Florida. Can you tell us what Key West was like in that period?
Well, it's a small town, very small. I think it was only 4 miles long. And I don't know the width. It was very, rather narrow. Back in the town itself, there were a couple of hotels. One was the Casa Marina, and that was run by the Navy Department. And I was able to have my wife come down there and stay at that place for about a year or so. And then there were several other hotels, but the Casa Marina was the one that President Truman went to after the war and brought back some memories. And then several years after the war, when we were down in Florida, we decided to go down to Key West and wanted to know the price of a room, and it was so expensive that I couldn't afford it. So, but nevertheless, we went down there, looked around, and enjoyed seeing the place again.
Now, you mentioned you had been married in 1942. And what was your wife's name? What is your wife's name?
Edith.
Edith. Right. And did you and Edith have a chance to have some off time during the war?
Well, when she was down there, and if I was in port, sure, of course. Mm-hmm. So she took a job with the Navy, though. And nobody had a car, but we did have a bicycle. And she used that bicycle to get to work every morning. And that was helpful, because at the time I was still a very junior officer, and we could have used the little extra funds that she was making. But she was very good and well-liked. She had done very well in civilian life as a checker for a very large hardware company of some sort. And she had to keep tabs on all the salespeople they had across the country. Mm-hmm. Her job was to make sure they made no mistakes. Mm. So she was very good at it. Mm-hmm. And enjoyed it.
Yeah. And Harold, how did you keep track of the other events in the war?
Well, it was minimal. We couldn't have radios on or anything like that. So whenever we could, we would try to get information as to what was happening. Mm-hmm. And you were able to get mail periodically.
Did you ever have a chance to go to, say, USO shows, concerts?
No, that's after more or less, if you took, if you went on leave. Mm-hmm. I did come home on leave one time. At that point, my first child, my oldest daughter, was 4 months old, and I thought the most beautiful thing in the world. She was such an adorable baby. Mm-hmm. Still is an adorable person. And she's a grandma now. And so it was an unforgettable experience. I was in full dress, white uniform, and saw this beautiful little child, and I have a picture of that somewheres at home. My favorite picture.
Mm-hmm. And when was this?
1944.
Okay. I'm going to actually kind of have you be brought back a little bit. I wanted to ask you what you were doing when Pearl Harbor was attacked in 1941.
I was still an enlisted person, mm-hmm. a petty officer in the hospital corps. But it happened that for that weekend, nobody knew this was going to happen, but for that weekend, I was assigned to the information desk. So we heard the Pearl Harbor news over the radio, And then the phone never stopped ringing. Parents kept calling. They wanted to know, my son is on the such and such vessel. Is he all right? Well, we had no more information than they did. All we could tell them was that we really don't have any more information, but perhaps Commandant 3rd Naval District might have. We didn't try to make them feel that for sure they're going to get better information, but we were very honest about it. Mm-hmm. Told them that we don't know, but they could try.
And were you aware where Pearl Harbor was?
Oh, I knew where Pearl Harbor was. It's just that we couldn't do very much about it. We were at the Brooklyn Navy Yard.
Right.
So that was an experience that was very touching, because you were dealing with people who felt they wanted to know if their child was alive.
Mm-hmm. Aside from your brother, did any friends or other family members join the service?
Yes, I had a cousin who was a very tough young man, a good-natured one, but wasn't afraid to get into fights. And he joined the Army. And while on active duty, a shell exploded very close to him and smashed his skull, so that he had to have a metal plate inserted where the skull was. Unfortunately, that affected him mentally to some degree. Mm-hmm. And he was never the same after that, and died young. So that was a personal loss that I felt, mm-hmm. although I didn't know about his death until well afterward. Because I liked him. He was a good cousin.
And you, of course, mentioned your brother earlier in the interview. He ended up in the Pacific Theater.
Yeah. As soon as my younger brother was old enough to be enlisted, when he was turned 17, I think it was, and I'm not sure, because he didn't write to me about all this until after he had gone through these invasions. But I was happy that he was alive. And it was fascinating information, but I wasn't happy to hear that, because it meant that the enemy was not playing by the rules.
Now, Harold, do you remember when the war ended?
Yes. At that time, before the war ended, actually, mm-hmm. I would say around July of 45, I don't remember for sure, I was ordered down to New Orleans, and I was named as the OTC for a group of vessels, which were auxiliary vessels that were just being completed in the New Orleans area. And my job was to take them from New Orleans and deliver them to Luzon in the Philippines. So I was very glad that I had all my experience in celestial navigation and so on. Even the fact that I had once taken geology in college was very useful, because when we didn't have any sophisticated equipment yet. We were one of the smaller vessels, and it was the big, very expensive ships that got the fancy equipment first, which made sense. But when we got down to Panama, we had been without any celestial help, because it was cloud for several days. The heavens were clouded. And when we got to a point where we thought we were, I decided I'll check out something that I learned at in geology class. And so I looked at the figures on the charts and compared them with the figures I was looking at. And sure enough, my dead reckoning, the dead reckoning means your best guess at where you were. The dead reckoning showed that I was in the place where those charts were. And I was able to ask for some additional help just to be sure. So I asked for a radio beam signal. Mm-hmm. And then I asked for a second one so that they would get a cross between two signals, in other words, meeting. And that gives you a pretty good idea of where you are. Okay. So that helped out a lot too, just thinking back to my college days.
Mm. Very practical.
Yeah.
No, you weren't through the canal, I take it, and out to the Pacific. What was that like?
Well, the Pacific was absolutely beautiful. Mm-hmm. I liked the Atlantic, but the Pacific was just a thing of beauty, so far as I was concerned. Every night, my job, incidentally, was called Officer and Tactical Command of these four ships. So each ship had a ship captain, and I did from the ship I was on, but in addition, I had command of these four ships. So on the way to Panama, one of the vessels developed a little bit of engine trouble, and so I asked the commanding officer of that vessel whether or not he would like to return to base and get the repairs done, or does he think he can make it to Pearl Harbor? And he got back to me and said he thinks we'll be able to make it okay, so he'd rather go on. So I accepted his thinking on it. Well, anyhow, we got to Pearl Harbor, and lo and behold, the vessel, the USS, I can't think of the name now, the ship upon which the treaty was signed, mm-hmm. and I can't think of the name.
The Missouri?
What?
The Missouri? USS Missouri?
Missouri, thank you. I couldn't. Mm-hmm. I don't know, at my age, I think I'm blocking out too often. And she was in for repairs, so no other vessel that was there was getting any service. I pulled in hoping that the vessel that had run into a little trouble should get repairs when we get to Pearl Harbor. So there were no repairs going on. Now, I had enough points by then so that when President Truman said if you had so many and so many points, you were able to go home. Well, I had the points before I left the States, but I went up to the commandant's office in New Orleans and told him I had more than enough points to go home. And they said, well, unfortunately, someone who's qualified enough to replace you probably would also have more than enough points. Maybe when you get to Panama. And I got the same story in Panama. Maybe when you get to Pearl Harbor. Well, by then I was getting a little fed up. I wanted to go home. I was getting homesick. And this went on every day. I'd go up to the personnel office, say, has anybody been picked as a relief? No, nothing yet. Come back tomorrow. And I did this for 9 days, and nothing happened. And meanwhile, the ship was unable to get any kind of repairs done because the USS Missouri was having repairs done.
So you're kind of stuck in limbo there.
Yeah. But I was a little bit determined, and so on the 10th day I went up. and expected the same thing would happen. But lo and behold, there was a familiar face there. We looked at each other, and I was so happy to see him. It was a classmate of mine who sat next to me in my English class at college. And I told him the story. And he said, "I'll get you a relief today. Today," he said. And he did.
Oh, bless your roommate.
This is a good case of not knowing what you know, but who you know. So sure enough, I was free to go home. And that was the end of my active duty, actually. I ended up somehow first in Texas and wherever, I don't know, or shipped around until I finally got to New York.
Just a bit of a what if. What if you were still stuck at Pearl Harbor, and then the following month, would you have been there when the Japanese signed the surrender?
Oh, the surrender had occurred already. This was after the Japanese surrender on that ship.
Okay.
Well after it, actually. And the ship needed some repairs.
Right.
So, of course, the USS Missouri, now a historical vessel, got first choice on everything. Mm-hmm.
Do you remember when the atomic bomb was dropped?
Yes, I do. And I must tell you very honestly, it sounds bloodthirsty, but I knew that if President Truman had said no, that we would have lost hundreds of thousands, perhaps, of our troops, because the Japanese were very good fighters, and they proved their mettle. So I was very happy that they used the atomic bomb to end the war.
Do you remember where you were when you heard about the news?
I was at Pearl Harbor.
Pearl Harbor, okay. So now you're heading home, you're in Texas.
More, I wasn't even sure where this happened to be not a Navy vessel. It was a very large freighter, had good speed and good accommodations. We had a little accident on there.
Oops.
One of the ship's lower level crew member had a little accident. He and some friends were playing cards, and they wanted to close the ship's the door, the waterproof door. Now, the waterproof doors are pretty heavy doors and maybe a little sharp out of the edge. I never tested that. Anyhow, this particular young gent was leaning back, was a little too lazy to get up and close the door, leaned back and tried to shut it, and it severed his finger, his thumb. So we had to radio for the nearest ship at sea with a physician aboard to come to our aid. And we met out in the someplace in the ocean based upon an agreed upon general area. And the physician that was sent aboard on one of the boats that they have as lifeboats really took a lot of chances, because the waves were not serious waves, but the whole ocean would seem to rise about 4 to 6 feet. And this physician had to manage to get aboard. And I think he deserved a little bit of a medal, too. But fortunately, he got aboard and did some temporary stitching, putting the thumb together and doing all the bandaging, and said, of course, as soon as he hits Panama, he should enter the hospital immediately. And that's what we did. Mm-hmm. So when we got to the hospital, he was left in their charge.
Okay.
But that was somebody who wasn't even a Navy man. He was member of the Merchant Marine, you see. But that's the kind of ship I was sent home on this giant freighter.
Okay, so now back to Texas, and then somehow, some way.
Wherever. I lost track of where I was being shipped back and forth in different places until I finally reached New York City.
Okay.
When
were you discharged from active duty?
I don't remember the exact date. Mm-hmm. It was sometime in November, actually, of 1945.
Okay. So tell us what happened afterward.
Well, I got to New York finally. Mm-hmm. I was given some discharge papers. They didn't have the forms that were used later on. I forget what the name was. But anyhow, I had some papers. And I had about 6 weeks or so of terminal leave because I hadn't really taken much vacation. So it built up over the 4 years or whatever. So that was that part of it. Mm-hmm. And then I decided I wanted to get as much education as I could. I heard of the GI Bill, and I was interested in the field of speech pathology. So I went down and went to the Board of Education, which was in New York, in Brooklyn, and I happened to be fortunate enough to meet a very nice lady who was in charge of the speech department for the city of New York, and Dr. Robichek was her name, her married name. Her maiden name was Murphy, but she married this gentleman who was head of a department. Mm-hmm. I don't remember what department he was running. At Theodore Roosevelt High School in New York. And so this turned into a terrific concept of help for me. She was very gracious, very happy that I came to see her, showed me a class in action, and we talked a little bit about which of the colleges or universities would be very useful in this field if I wanted to specialize in it. And she said, well, there are a couple. I teach at New York University, and I have a friend, Dorothy Mulgrave, who was also a very nice person, and she is a friend of mine. So there'd be two people, you know. Mm-hmm. Anyhow, to make a long story short, I decided I will go to NYU and signed up. So that was a good choice, as it happened. And my years with NYU were very enjoyable. In fact, that very first year, one of my professors was the dean of the School of Education. I spent 6 months, or 5 months, whatever it was, per semester. And towards the end of the course, he said, may I see you for a few minutes? Of course. I went over, we talked, and he said, there's a group of colleges and universities along the Eastern Seaboard that would like to form an Eastern Seaboard group. And they invited the colleges and universities along the Eastern Seaboard to send one professor and one student from each of the colleges. and I'd like you to be the student representing the student body. Well, this was a very large student body, and I thought that was quite an honor. So, of course, I accepted. Unfortunately, that organization didn't somehow gel, didn't work out, but it was an interesting experience. And I was given a strange assignment, which I had no special training for. I led a group of people who were on the panel, and the title of the panel was Contributions of the American Negro to Our Society. Well, I knew a little bit about George Washington Carver and a little bit about a couple of others, but they weren't really household names. So before I left for Virginia, I think it was, where the conference was being held, I decided I'd better look these up a little. That was a good thing, because otherwise I would have felt stupid about it. So that was a very interesting experience, and I felt very honored that the dean of the university has picked me out. Interestingly, some years later, when I was about to graduate, you had to take a course called the 400-level course with the dean of the School of Education. But by this time, there was a new dean, because the old dean was a nice gentleman, Dr. Lyman Graybeal, I never forgot his name, and he was already retired. So this other gentleman, I can never remember his first name, his last name was Rosecrans, also a wonderful person. I took to him right away, thought, here was a nice guy, I like him. And apparently he liked me too, because towards the end of the course, he invited the class, and there were only 15 of us, because many people dropped by the highway, so to speak. They kept weeding people out, and they made it very hard to enter this program. You had to take 9 hours of testing, very powerful testing. It was really a super IQ, the way I figured it. And you didn't know how you made out unless they told you, yes, you are eligible now. So that was quite an ordeal, by the way. And I didn't find out through the normal channels, but the chairman of my department knew that I was taking that test, and she came to me and said, I want you to know that you did exceptionally well. Well, that was quite a lift, because you had no way of knowing. Right. It was a really tough test, which went on 3 hours each Saturday for three consecutive Saturdays. So 9 hours of testing in order to determine whether you could enter the PhD program. Anyhow, I took a course with this Dr. Rosecrans, who was then the new dean, and we had a wonderful group of people, including the head nurse of Bellevue Hospital, the mental department. The Bellevue Hospital was a top-notch hospital for people with severe mental problems. And this lady was the head nurse there. So she was one of them. We had a priest who was, I can't think of the name of his order, but one of the higher levels of priests. And we had 15 people who had proven ourselves to be pretty good. Mm-hmm. And so at the end of the semester, he invited us all to his home for a little party. And when I came in, I met his charming wife, and she said to me, I must tell you, I think I know as much about you as anybody else could. My husband always talked to me about you. And she was so pleased to meet me. I felt we were old buddies. So it was a terrific feeling. Mm. And it was the kind of thing where you met people that you liked mostly. There were very few people that I didn't like, but some of them were outstanding. And so I'm saying I had a very good graduate life.
Harold, tell us a little more about your time in the Naval Reserves.
Well, when I came back from the service, I had a lot of problems to think about. One was, how was I going to achieve my goal of becoming a speech pathologist? What would I do in the meanwhile to earn a living to support my wife and children? And what would be my long-range goal? Actually, how do I get there? So, of course, the first thing I did was to sign up for my master's degree. And that went very well. And as time went on, I kept taking more and more courses, but I was teaching full time because as soon as I earned my master's, I found a position as the speech department, one-man speech department, at the Mount Vernon Public Schools in Mount Vernon, New York. And I went about starting the business from scratch. Did my surveys of the entire school system, actually testing all the elementary kids. I knew I couldn't get to the secondary school very much because there would be no time left in the week. So I concentrated on the elementary level, and that worked out very well. And eventually, after some years, I was running it all by myself. But then gradually, the superintendent realized that we can use more help and apparently got some good reports for me, about me and what have you. So eventually we had three new people. So the job was now divided among four of us. And I was very happy about that, but I was sort of head of department. And this went on for many years. And I wasn't looking for any publicity, but for whatever reason, my name was being referred to people who needed help to contact me from surrounding towns. How they got my name or how they knew anything about me, I don't know.
Shades of your father.
Well, you know, I figured they must have gotten some help from somebody in town. And I was very successful. So in addition to my work at school, I set up an office at home. And I didn't take any students from the school system because they were my responsibility during the day, during the school day. But these were people who ranged from, well, all kinds of, shall we say, titles, including several electrical specialists, electrical engineers. And then that also included a physician who had a practice in ear, nose, and throat in Washington, D.C., and wanted to change to another specialty. Mm-hmm. So he came up to Mount Vernon area and was hooked up to the Veterans Administration somehow to be able to get some training. And one of the things they wanted him to do was to give talks to nurse groups. Well, that scared the heck out of him. And so he told them, I'm not used to talking to groups. I would need help. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't know who referred him, but somebody referred him to me. And we were very successful. And for years afterwards, he kept sending me Christmas cards and telling me how many groups he had actually talked to that year. And of course, it made me feel very good.
So back to your days with the Naval Reserve. I take it that was all during your time as a speech pathologist?
Oh, yes. Yeah, that was my daytime work.
Right.
And I was with them for a number of years. Mm-hmm. My job was the education officer. So what I did was to train the petty officers in methods of teaching, how to utilize visual aids, how to prepare a lesson plan, that sort of thing. Mm. And they were in turn teaching the the lesser people who were not petty officers. Okay.
Harold, when did you retire from the Naval Reserves?
Well, you were automatically discharged in those mm-hmm. days. So after my terminal leave, I felt I was ready to do anything I pleased.
And what year was that?
1946, yeah.
And what rank were you at the end of your term?
I was a senior lieutenant who was due for promotion. And I didn't want to hang around. Mm-hmm. I was offered a chance to stay with the Navy, but I figured if I did, I would be losing time that I felt was important for the rest of my life. Whereas I felt that I did my job for my mm-hmm. country when I was needed. And by the way, my father was a gung-ho patriot from way back. So I sort of learned a lot from him in terms of love of country. It was sort of God and country were the things you mm-hmm. had to respect.
Right.
So I stayed with the Navy group, taught these people how to teach, made sure that it worked out well. And then after a couple of years, the Navy decided that they were going to have a school for naval officers. So it was called NROS, Naval Reserve Officer School. NROS. And there were NROSs established across the country. So when I heard of it, I decided I'd like to be a part of that. I'd find that more useful and more along my lines of interest. So I signed up to teach celestial navigation. And that's what I did. I did that for several years. Mm-hmm. And then I heard of an opening in a larger school where the man who was the head of department was the head of the Museum of Natural History, Hayden Planetarium in New York. And I can't think of his name right now. But right now there's this black gentleman, and I can't think of his name, who runs it, a very nice, capable chap. But anyhow, he was the department head. When I came in, I was the more senior officer and automatically became the chairman of the department. And went on like this to another school later on. And this time, it was somebody who was chairman, who was who headed up the Hayden Planetarium. But it was not this gentleman I was talking about. This was his successor, mm-hmm. who was also a Navy man, you see. So this fellow did a favor for me. He said, how would it be if I invited the entire school one night and we set up the planetarium to be a teaching experience, a learning experience? And that's what we did. Okay. So one night, the entire school, instead of meeting at the school, came to the Hayden Planetarium. We had a special setup that had been purposely developed for basic things, so you learned what azimuth was, you saw it, and that sort of thing. And this was a new experience for many of the officers who had never had that training.
Cool.
And so I stayed with it and became the executive officer of one of these schools. I was with them for a number of years. And then found a school much closer to home. We lived in Mount Vernon, New York, and the next town over was Yonkers, New York, one of the towns that was on that side of Mount Vernon. And I stayed with them for a number of years because I finally became commanding officer and director of the Naval Reserve Officer School. So I stayed for the 3 years maximum that you're allowed. And by then, I was well past the retirement requirements, so I retired. Mm-hmm. And I took a job as a high school principal.
And where was this?
In Cold Spring, New York. It was called the Hal Dane Senior High School, Hal Dane. Mm-hmm. It was a nice central school, and the building housed not only the high school, but on the other side of it, there was the junior high.
Okay.
I didn't stay with them very long, although I liked the people and so on, but it was a long ride every day for me. It was about 40 miles each way. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, with a car, you make it in an hour, and if you're not going in the wrong direction. Because you go with traffic, it's kind of slow. If you go against the traffic where there's very little going on, that's what I was doing. So I did that. And while I was there, I made a lot of friends and was well liked. But I heard that the town next to where I lived, the town was Pelham, it was having an opening for a high school principal. So I applied and I got the job.
And how long were you principal out in Pelham?
4 years. Mm-hmm. And we decided that we would like to live up in Massachusetts, where both my married daughters, they were now married, you see, and married daughters were living in Framingham. So I applied for a position up here through the university, and there were no openings for superintendents. But I did visit some of the superintendents of my own and asked if they knew of any openings. And there was one gentleman who followed up with the one of his colleagues in Wilmington, Massachusetts. So I applied in Wilmington, and the superintendent told me they don't have an opening for what I want, but would I be interested in being the, the director, let us say, I can't remember the precise title, director of special services. So that put me in a number three spot, the superintendent, the assistant superintendent, and then my slot. So I was in charge of just about everything that wasn't under the usual teacher or whatever. Mm. Anyhow, so let's see. Yeah, that worked out very nicely. And I was there for 4 years and was very popular with all the principals, all the teachers. I had countless friends.
Okay.
And I had a nice office, mm-hmm. and a very good secretary. So it was a very pleasant period of time. And after 4 years, they ran into a serious problem. They had lost about 1,000 students. I don't know how, but that was something that started before I arrived. And they felt they just couldn't afford to pay for my job. They had to have a choice, either fire teachers or let me go.
Mm-hmm.
And I told them that I agree with them. It made the most sense. And we left as very good friends. Meanwhile, somebody there was looking out for a job for me and told me about one in the city of Beverly. So I went there and stayed for a number of years and then retired.
Harold, did you join any veterans organizations?
Actually, I took a look at the American Legion, which was in my town in Sudbury. And they seemed like nice enough guys, but basically I felt it was an organization where the people got together, played cards, drank beer, and I felt that was not exactly what I was looking for. So much as I appreciate them, I felt it was not my cup of tea.
Did you ever attend reunions?
A union?
A reunion with your old shipmates.
A reunion, did you say?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I thought about that recently, but at the time, I was sort of in transit. I had finished command of my ship and then was going to these other ships that they sent me to down in New Orleans and as the OTC. And so I never really had an opportunity to consider that.
Okay. How, as we're wrapping up this interview, how important was it for you to serve in the military?
How important was it?
Yes.
It was very important for me. I liked the people I dealt with. I felt that we had a common cause, all patriotic. And so it was my way of feeling that I'm still helping my country and was available in case of emergency.
Well, Harold, you had a very long and interesting life.
Well, I have, but I'll tell you, the one thing that was even more important to me mm-hmm. was earning the PhD, mm-hmm. because the hurdles that you had to overcome in order to be able to get that degree There were many. And the funny thing is, when I first started, I saw a little pamphlet, a little booklet actually, run by the graduates of NYU. I forget the name of the what they call themselves. But anyhow, they put out this booklet highlighting all the horrible steps that they put the PhD candidates through. And, you know, they in other words, the university didn't want to give away these degrees. They wanted people who they felt had the ability to or deserved to be considered for it. So I wanted that challenge. And it took a long time because I was busy working, taking courses, trying to supplement my income by having private people as well. And so it was a long, hard row to follow, but I made it. And I'm very happy about it.
Well, Harold Homefield, we thank you so much for coming and taking part in the Natick Veterans Oral History Project.
Well, it's my pleasure because you made it very simple and easy for me.